the people. Let us pray to the
Lord.
For the nation under our government, those who protect us, let us pray to the
Lord.
For this city, every city, country, for the faithful who live in them, let us pray to the
Lord.
For the good matter of abundance of the fruits of the earth, for the peaceful times, let us pray to the
Lord. Suffering
for those held captive and for their salvation, let us pray to the
Lord. Have mercy.
For the servant of God Phil and for his blessed memory, for the forgiveness of all his offenses, voluntary and involuntary, let us pray to the
Lord. Have mercy.
That he may stand blameless before the awesome tribunal of Christ, making entry to the land of the living, the place of light where all the just repose. Let us pray to the
Lord. Have mercy.
That we may be delivered from all tribulation and misfortune. Let us pray to the
Lord. Have mercy.
Have hope and save, have mercy, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy. Remembering
most holy Michael, most blessed Lord's Lady, the Mother of God and ever Virgin Mary, together with all the saints, let's commend ourselves and one another, O life to Christ, our God. For glory, honor, worship, we meet you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Christ our God. To you,
Lord, your holy God, give
reading from the Epistle of the Holy Apostle Paul to the Philippians.
Let us be attentive.
Bracia y sestra, brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Everyone should see how unselfish you are. The Lord is near. Dismiss all anxiety from your minds. Present your needs to God in every form of prayer and in petitions full of gratitude. Then God's own peace, which is beyond all understanding, will stand guard over your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, my brethren, your thoughts should be wholly directed to all that is true, all that deserves respect, all that is honest, pure, admirable, decent, virtuous, or worthy of praise. Live according to what you have learned and accepted, what you have heard me say and seen me do. Then will the God of peace be with you.
Peace to you. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia.
Jesus had raised from the dead. The fact was, the chief priests planned to kill Lazarus too, because many Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him on the account of Lazarus. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was to enter Jerusalem. So they cut palm branches and came out to meet him. They kept shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found the donkey and mounted it in accordance with the scripture, "Fear not, O daughter of Zion. Your king approaches on a donkey colt." At first, the disciples did not understand all this, but after Jesus was glorified, they recalled that the people had done to him precisely what had been written about him. The crowd that was present when Jesus called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead kept testifying to it. The crowd came out to meet him because they heard he had performed this. Today we remember our prayers of Phil Rizak. He was a cantor for many, many years, as requested by Mark Bouchon. And there are bulletins over the Easter weekend or the Passion weekend, starting today. There are many changeable prayers that the cantor leads. So follow them in your bulletin, and they are bulletins. So there's a printed bulletin with some. What we have, but please visit online bulletin of our website for the full account. But you know, there is some to print this or take this, and then there's a little basket if you're able to absolutely make a donation towards the, buy the flowers for Easter and Resurrection. Just a quick reminder: Holy Thursday, 6 p.m. The Holy Thursday. Divine Liturgy with 3 p.m. on Friday, Good Friday, the Vespers and procession will line the Holy Shroud. Again, if you're able for health reasons and otherwise you're healthy, a complete abstinence, no meat or dairy products on that day. On the Holy Thursday, again, 10 o'clock, the Divine Liturgy, and on Easter Sunday, we start with the prayers in the tombs, and then it's a chain of liturgies and services with conclusion of the Easter Sunday Divine Liturgy, plus the blessing of food, Paschal food, to follow in the church hall. There is a benefit concert, Basil Papadiouk and Papadiouk Band. They perform here on Insania on April 12th. If you like the music, he's the famous violinist. So more than welcome to attend this concert. Again, information in bulletin. May the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. There are little differences from time to time. I point to you that, you know, between Byzantine tradition and the Roman tradition. And one of them, Lent, the way we calculate Lent ends. Today is, if you were to go to the one of the big churches, Eastern Rite churches, you know, you will see, you know, iconostas in a different, there we actually rows of icons. We have really two major icons and then one about the 12 disciples. But, you know, in the, one of my churches that I serve, you know, there'll be one more row and there will be 12 major feasts. So, and today is really one of the 12 major feasts. Christ entered into Jerusalem. So, and that happened on the Lazarus Sunday when you remember the story from the Gospel, when Martha was asking, "Come, my brother is really sick and he's dying." And then when he did finally come, she really challenged him, "If you were here, he wouldn't die." And then, he came on the fourth day. Today's liturgy is a Sunday liturgy, so that would be, but morning liturgy would be Saturday of Lazarus, when Christ raised Lazarus or brought him back to the life. Why on the fourth day? Why did he wait those 4 days? One of the reasons, in the Jewish tradition, fourth day was, this is it, the door is locked. It's not he's not coming back. On the first and the second day again, well, but the fourth day in the Jewish tradition was you are completely dead, you're not coming back. So maybe that was behind Christ in a way teaching that he came not on the first or the second, on the fourth day, and brought Lazarus back to life. So this for now, for the Byzantine tradition, the Lent is over with this feast of the Christ entered to Jerusalem, and now we are starting the Holy Week. So Lent is over in a way. The holy days, 40 days, are completed. So when you listen to today's reading, it's a totally different tone. For the past 5 weeks, the Sundays of the Lent, we've heard the words of the apostle as he addressed the Hebrews. He instructed us about God's promises. He talked about our sins. He talked about types of sacrifice and so on. But in today's epistle, Paul says, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then to further emphasize it, he repeats, again, I say rejoice. We can already anticipate the beautiful refrain that to the mother of God, Theotokos, that will be sung and you'll hear next Sunday. Rejoice, O pure virgin. Again, I say, rejoice. Your son is risen from his 3 days in the tomb. So certainly the events of yesterday, when I say yesterday, but this liturgy be meant to be on Sunday, so I would refer to Lazarus Saturday, and Christ's triumphant entrance into Jerusalem are dramatic and exciting events about which we should rejoice. Yet, on the other hand, knowing that events will transpire, what will happen on the Good Friday, the Passion Week, this message may seem to be a little inappropriate or disturbing for some people, but really it should not be. This message is given to us to strengthen us and prepare us for the events that are to occur. While our Lord, he was still alive, we remember that when he took 3 apostles, James and Peter and John, he took them up to the Mount Tabor and he transfigured in front of them, really to prepare them for what will happen, that he will die on the cross. So too does the church prepare us with such encouragement, with this one of the 12 feasts, this beautiful entry into Jerusalem. Fathers of the church have wisely chosen this portion of the scripture to be heard today, especially since on the last 2 Sundays, Christ himself has been preparing his disciples and us for terrible things that were about to happen to him. So we most certainly do not want our rejoicing to be delusional or to be empty, some sort of empty praise and flattery, or to be an inconsistent celebration which evolve into rejoicing and mockery of our Lord as that happened to him a long time ago. Our rejoicing must be true and honorable and worthy, not in spite of what we are about to witness and go through on the Good Friday, but rather because of those events. Some may ask, how can we rejoice when we are about to witness the ugly and terrible suffering of our Lord? This is, of course, precisely why we are rejoicing. St. Paul continues his message, the Lord is near. Have no anxieties about anything. Many things can and may and will happen in our lives. But Christian joy can overcome this. We have seen that even though he is God, Christ is also a man who has encountered these terrible and evil things as well. He did not run from them or try to avoid them. Rather, he embraced them and turned them into something good. So Christian joy is so different from the way the world rejoices, and for different reasons. Christian joy does not necessarily require laughing and cheering and clapping or some other outward demonstrations. Christian joy stands independent of anything and everything that happens in life, because it is grounded in the continual presence of Christ. The church at Philippi was an infant church, not yet fully committed. Lonely community that was being tried and prosecuted. Sometimes we as individuals feel exactly like that. That is why St. Paul boosts their morale with this message: Christ is with you. Have no anxiety. So the closer we approach the Lord's trial, as we see the Old Testament prophecies being fulfilled, we rejoice before them and during them, because we already know the ultimate victory. Some biblical scholars have given this epistle that was read the first two names. The first is obvious, as we see from what it's already what I already said, the epistle of joy. The other name is the epistle of excellent things, because of verse 8 of this reading, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy to praise, think about these things. So here is our focus for this week. Our mindset must be above the merely ordinary matters of our living. We are called upon to develop nobility of thought, to refine our higher instincts, to lift our senses to new heights. We need to be near to our Savior each and every day of this week, to walk with Him, to learn from Him, to be encouraged by Him, so that we will not be given over to despair as His disciples were. For 40 days we have wandered across desert of land, as the fathers of our church have described it. And like Moses and the other holy men and women were, we ought to be changed by that experience. In the beautiful Cecile DeMille classic, and it always comes around this time, during this time of the year, the Ten Commandments, the narrator of that movie emphasizes this fact. Moses has been exiled from Egypt by the Pharaoh Ramses, at the edge of the desert with only one ration of food and one ration of water and stuff. But he survived by God's grace, and like other holy men before him, he's purged and purified so that now he can meet God face to face. He stands before the foot of Mount Sinai. We too now stand at the foot of this holy week, prepared and ready to encounter an even greater and more awesome event than the burning bush, namely the passion and death of God Himself, the Son of God, Christ. So our journey through the great land has hopefully deepened our faith, by intense prayer, by really sincere fasting, charitable deeds perhaps, maybe more spiritual readings than any given other time, and many other good works. So we must continue, for now is the holiest time of the year. We enter it this very evening singing, "Come then, let us walk with Him, minds purified, and let us be crucified with Him and die with Him, so far as the pleasure of the life are concerned, that we may live with Him," and hear Him declare, I no longer go the earthly Jerusalem to suffer. I ascend rather to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God, and I will raise you up with me to that Jerusalem which is above, to the kingdom of heaven. Glory to Jesus Christ. Let us all say with our whole soul, O mighty Lord, let us say, O mighty Lord of our fathers, we pray, hear us and have mercy. Have mercy on us, O God, the greatest of our passion, we pray, you hear us and have mercy. Those who serve and have served in His Holy Church, our spiritual fathers, all brother in Christ.
Lord, have mercy.
We also pray for our nation, our government, those who protect us.
Lord, have mercy.
We also pray to Almighty Lord God, our fathers, to deliver Ukraine from all evil. May He have mercy and heal this land. May He give Ukraine peace and the chance to develop as a nation that values truth, justice, and freedom, all rooted in the goodness of God. For this, too, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For we also pray for the people here present who have great manifold mercies. Those be kind to us. And for all Orthodox Christians.
Lord, have mercy.
For your merciful loving God, give glory to your Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Amen.
Again and again in peace, let the faithful pray to the Lord. Glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Thank you.
benefactor of this holy church, all of your Orthodox Christians, now and forever and ever.
Being and undivided,
Send down upon your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts here present, making this bread the precious body of your Christ. Amen. Presenting this child in the precious blood of your Christ and changing them by your Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Especially our most holy mother, most blessed and glorious Lady, the Mother of God and ever Virgin Mary. Spirit.
Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. Remember me, O Master, when you come into your kingdom. Remember me, O Holy One, when you come into your kingdom. May the partaking of your holy mysteries, O Lord, be unto me not for judgment or condemnation, but for the healing of soul and body. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. God, cleanse me of my sins and have mercy on me. I have sinned without number. Forgive me, O Lord.
Approach with the fear of God and with faith.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. God the Lord has appeared to us.
Protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Protect the fullness of your church, sanctify those who love the beauty of your house, and glorify them by your divine power. Do not forsake us, good hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to your churches, to the priests, to our nation, and to our government, all your people. For good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from you. The Father of lights will give glory, thanks, and worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord. O Lord, our God, who sit upon the cherubim and who restore the might of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, that through his cross and burial and resurrection he might save the world, who also, when today he entered Jerusalem to embark upon his voluntary passion, he was led by the people who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, bearing the symbols of victory, pods of trees and branches of palms, emblematic of the resurrection. Keep and preserve us also, who on this pre-festal day, in imitation of them, bear in our hands palms and bonds, and like those nations and children who cry to you, Hosanna, may we likewise with him and spiritual song be made worthy of the life-giving resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and with whom you are blessed together with your all holy, gracious, life-giving Spirit, now and forever and ever. These palms are blessed by the Spirit's sprinkling of this holy water. May the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The blessing of the Lord be upon with his grace and love for mankind always, now, forever and ever. St. George, great Martin, the patron of the Church and of all the saints, have mercy and save us for his good. He loves the man and God.